See what you missed last week at Calvary Tabernacle.
Who raised somebody from the dead. I serve an everlasting God. I serve an everlasting King.
Cause we know you are mighty. You are mighty. You are mighty.
There are people in this house that know that when they open their mouth, they could snatch someone from the burning. There are people in this room that weep at night because God save lost humanity. Save my family. Save my loved ones. Save them. And the truth is, when we get to that place where we can intercede and love people more than we love ourselves, we will fulfill our job as his witness. We will let the world see that God is not only real, but God is coming again.
Oh, bless you, God. We give you praise. Hallelujah, Jesus.
Hallelujah, we bless your name, God. We give you glory. Hallelujah, we bless you. You are God alone, Jesus, and we give you the glory this morning. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah. Oh. God created by human hands. You are not a God dependent on any mortal man. You are not a God in need of anything we can give by your hand. That's just the way it is. You are not a God created by human hands. You are not a God mortal man. You are not a God in need of anything we can give by your hand. That's just the way it is. Oh, you are God alone. From before time began,
you are on your throne.
And you are God alone.
You are God. are on your throne, and you are God alone. Oh, and right now, in the good times, amen, you are on your throne, and you King this morning. Let's worship the living King this morning. He is not alone. We serve a risen Savior in this world today.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Lord. Hallelujah, Jesus. This moment, God. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord, everybody. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. We're going to go to the Lord in prayer right now. Hallelujah. I just want us to remember the Crosdale family who's recovering from illness, the names that are on the board for healing and restoration, those that need comfort that are grieving at this time. Just take a name or two and lift up their name. Hallelujah. Let's go to the throne room. Father, I come to you in the name of Jesus. No other name under heaven whereby men can be saved but the name of Jesus. God, we give you glory today. We thank you, God, that we can come boldly to the throne of grace crying, Abba, Father, for grace and for mercy, God. You are the great I am, the great Jehovah. You are Lord of all and you are Lord of the host. The angelic host. We thank you, God, that we are seated together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. And we're joint heirs with God, with Christ. We thank you, God, that we are far above principalities and powers. So therefore, we can war from a high place today. God, we thank you and we praise you, Lord Jesus, for you are God and God alone, and you're seated on the throne. There's no one like Jehovah. Hallelujah, Jesus. Father, we ask you right now to search us, oh God, and know our hearts. Try us and know our thoughts. See if there be any wicked ways in us. Uproot it right now, God. Pluck it up. Cut it off at the roots, God, in the name of Jesus. Take a live coal off your altar and place it on our lips today, God, that we may be clean. Let our conversation be full of grace and seasoned with salt so that we will know how to answer at all times. Let the words of our mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our strength and our redeemer. God, I pray that you forgive us of our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us in the name of Jesus. Let flesh decrease and you increase today, God. Be exalted in us, God. Be lifted high in us in the name of Jesus. God, sanctify us today. Consecrate us today, Lord Jesus. Purify us, God. Create in us a clean heart and renew a right spirit within us in the name of Jesus. There is therefore now no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus, who walk not after the flesh but after the spirit. God, we thank you today, Lord Jesus. Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on us today. Make us and mold us after your own way, God. Oh, God, let your kingdom come and let your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Father, we thank you today, God, for we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against rulers of the darkness, against spiritual wickedness in high places. But thanks be unto God who causes us to triumph. Thanks be unto God who's given us the victory through Jesus Christ. God, we thank you right now for the weapons of our warfare, not carnal, but they're mighty through God in the pulling down of strongholds, casting down every imagination, everything that exalts itself against the knowledge of God, bringing into captivity our thoughts unto the Lord Jesus. We thank you, God, that you have equipped us today. For your word said, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God that we may be able to stand against the wiles of the enemy. God, we thank you today for the helmet of salvation, the breastplate of righteousness, God, Abosanda, the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God, the shield of faith, oh God, the belt, oh God, your belt of truth, and our shoes, oh God, shod with the gospel of peace. We thank you today, God, that we will walk, oh God, in you, Lord Jesus, for in you we live, we move, and we have our being, oh God. We thank you for your strength today, God. Abasanda. Strength, oh God, like no other that reaches for us, oh God. Your strength is made perfect in us right now, God. We pray for healing right now. Healing, oh God, for the names that are on the board, oh God, and those that are not, Lord Jesus. You are the healer, oh God. You are the great physician. You are Jehovah Rapha, God. Abosedekia. You are El Shaddai, the many-breasted one, oh God, the God that more than enough. You are Jehovah Jireh, God, our provider, God. Jehovah Nisi, our banner, God. Jehovah Shammah, you're here with us. Harabosedekia, your presence is here. Jehovah Roi, you see us, God. You see and you know everything about us, God. You know our uprising and you know our downsitting, God. You know everything, God. Lord, we thank you and praise you, Lord Jesus, for healing in your house today, for deliverance in your house today, God. We thank you, God, that you send your power, God. Oh, God, it's not by might, not by power, it's by your Spirit, saith the Lord. We thank you, God, that your strength is here today, that there's joy in your house today, that weeping may endure for a night, but joy is coming in the morning, that those who sow in tears shall reap in joy. God, I thank you, God, that you are our high priest. You are touched with the feelings of our infirmities, God. You know everything that we are in need of right now. And I pray, God, that you'll meet us at our point of need. I pray that your word will go forth, God, and it will fall on good ground. Lord Jesus, we thank you for your word, oh God, that is settled in heaven, Lord Jesus. You watch over your word to perform it, and the angels hearken to your word. So right now, oh God, let your word penetrate, God. Let it take up root, God. Let it fall on good ground, oh God. Let not the enemy steal the word, oh God, in the name of Jesus. For faith cometh by hearing and hearing by the word of God. We ask you right now, oh God, to touch Bishop Barrington Golson, Pastor Robert Stewart, oh God. God, gird them with strength. Make their way perfect, God. Enlarge their steps that they will not slip, God, in the name of Jesus. We thank you and we praise you, God, for you are a mighty God. What a mighty God we serve. In Jesus' mighty name I pray. Amen and amen. Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord, saints. Today's scripture reading will be from Matthew chapter 14, verses 22 through 33, and Mark chapter 4, verses 35 through 41. We will read alternatively, and the last verse we will read in one accord. Matthew verse four, chapter 14 says, "And straightway Jesus constrained his disciples to get into a ship and to go before him unto the other side while he sent the multitudes away." The ship was now in the midst of the sea, tossed with waves, for the wind was contrary.
And in the fourth watch of the night, Jesus went unto them, walking on the sea.
And when the disciples saw him walking on the sea, they were troubled, saying, "It is a spirit," and they cried out for fear. And Peter answered him and said, "Lord, it be thou. Bid me come unto thee on the water."
And he said, "Come." And when Peter was come down on the ship, he walked on the water to go to Jesus.
But when he saw the wind boisterous, he was afraid, and beginning to sink, he cried, saying, "Lord, save me." And when they were come into the ship, the wind ceased. Mark chapter 4. And the same day, when the even was come, he saith unto them, "Let us pass over unto the other side."
And when they had sent away the
arose a great storm of wind, and the waves beat into the ship, so that it was now full. And he arose and rebuked the wind and said unto the sea, Peace, be still. And the wind ceased, and there was a great calm.
And he said unto them, Why are ye so fearful? How is it that ye have faith?
And together, and they feared exceedingly, and said one to another, What manner is this, that even the wind and the sea obey him? Here ends the reading of God's word.
Amen. You may take your seats if you haven't already. I'm glad to be here. Are you?
Amen.
Praise the Lord. Welcome to Calvary. We're so glad you chose to worship with us today. If you're tuned in on Facebook or YouTube, we'd like to welcome you as well. We are connecting through relationships. Last week, Pastor reminded us to connect to the cause. It's okay. I'll give you a second chance. Last week, Pastor reminded us to connect to the cause. Amen. Using the story of John the Baptist, he reminded us that the kingdom of heaven is at hand, and we are responsible to share the good news with those around us while we can. How many are ready to be a witness? Amen. Amen. We celebrate all March birthdays. If you have a birthday in the month of March, or if your birthday is today, would you please stand so we can celebrate you? March birthdays. Amen. If you don't see your name on the screen and you would like it to be there, please contact the church office. As always, Tuesday is our church's prayer and fasting day, and we are asking everyone to fast from 6 a.m. to 6 p.m. We invite all members to join us in the sanctuary for a time of prayer from 7 p.m. to 8 p.m. as you prepare our hearts for Palm Sunday. We have some good news. The Calvary Tabernacle Choir's music video of their Easter single, Yes, I Know He Lives, with national recording artist Monique Walker, will be released on YouTube this coming Friday, March 22nd. So that's this Friday, March 22nd. In this season, you can also download this single that is on all streaming platforms. So if you have Spotify or Apple Music or a third one, you can get it there as well. Handmaidens Women's Conference is coming, and it's going to be from May 16th to May 19th with special guest Dr. Bonnie Hunter. They're going to be going away and having the conference at a retreat location. So mark your calendars and plan for an exciting weekend trip. If you would like to become a member of this great church, our new members class is open, and they also offer Zoom classes. Please ask an usher for more information. Follow us on all social media platforms and keep updated. You are also invited to download the church app to stay connected. We are in full Easter preparation mode. Amen. And we want to celebrate all those who committed to help this Easter. If you have not turned in your Easter commitment card, you can fill one out and turn it in today. So if you don't have a commitment card or you don't know what I'm talking about, you can raise your hand and the ushers will get one to you. We're asking all leaders to meet on the third floor after church for our final strategy meeting leading up to Resurrection Sunday. So if you're a leader, please join us on the third floor after church today. Today we celebrate all those that finished an 8-week course for the winter semester. Graduation. We've also compiled the course transcripts for each student that has taken an 8 weeks course over the years. So if you've ever taken an 8 weeks course at Calvary, they have your classes together in a transcript. If you did not get your transcript, please reach out to the church office. Those will be very valuable to you in the future. Please look at the screen as we share some highlights from the 8 weeks course while our students from Purposeful Prayer class assemble on my left, this side, And those that are in marriage or single, assemble on my right, which is this side.
Praise the Lord, everyone. It's a great day to be in the house of the Lord. At this time, we're going to be asking Purposeful Prayer to come up, and the teacher, Lady Janice, would you come, please? Quickly, let's...
Praise the Lord, everyone. This morning, it's a delight and honor to just recognize all our students. We had a wonderful time in the class, and I just wanted to call their names. Sister Andrea Henriquez. Sister Wendella Blackman. Just please applaud them for, thank you. Brother Dale Brissett, Sr. Brother Siobhan Dimash. Sister Mahalia Gallimore, Brother Kramer Hammond, Sister Paulette John, Sister Christina Johnson, Sister Yvonne Smith, Brother Paul Smith, Sister Kadeen Baxter Mitchell, Elder Debbie White, Elder Dawn Williams, and Sister Marcia Wright. Please give them a round of applause for completion of the course.
Thank you. Could you give them a round of applause one more time, please? Thank you, Purposeful Prayer. Next, we'll be having How to be happy, single, or married. Could you come quickly? Elder Horton taught this class, one of the most exciting classes that went on this season.
Everybody, this was a great class, lots of fun. Sister Carol Beckles, the Rome Ball. I had a favorite student, Sister Andrea Brown, Myra Deans, Everett Garrick, Judith Garrick was my favorite couple. Desmarie Hyatt, Melissa Shane John, Melissa Kelly, John Malcolm, Yashane Murphy, Sister Eileen Panthier, Janet Roach, Nisha Walters, a very one of the most excited students. Philip Walters, Christopher Williams, this was a highly animated group and we enjoyed it.
Thank you, if you could give them a round of applause again everyone, thank you. Next we will have Salt and Light. Bish and Minister Keon Mirage.
Praise the Lord, everyone. So good to have another class that has been discipled and they're ready. We'll call the names. Can you give them a hand? It's a great class to teach with my assistant, Minister Keon Mirage. We'll be calling the names and giving the MC. Sister Marco Banton. Give her a hand, please. Brother and Sister Doman, they finished the class, but they're not here. They're away for their anniversary, so we celebrate them. Chanel, Sister Chanel, congratulations. Sister Maria Green, thank you. Kathleen Henry, Adia John, Robert Maduro. Congratulations, Sister Josephine McFarlane, Sister Tanya, Tasha. Congratulations again. We celebrate them on this great accomplishment.
Praise the Lord, everyone. Could you give them a round of applause? And at this time, while Old Testament and spiritual gifts is lining up, let's go into a time of worship. God bless you.
Praise the Lord. Praise is what I do.
Praise is what I do.
In sickness.
Praise is what I do.
In depression.
We'll have our Old Testament class that was led by Elder Joan Seely. Praise God.
Praise the Lord, everyone. Okay. I just want to congratulate the Old Testament class, which was really focused and even complained that the time was too short. So welcome them today as they graduate from this class. We have first Brother Bangudu. Brother Michael Benjamin, Sergey Gruger, Sister Donna Green, Sister Kenya Matthews, Sister Zita McKenzie, Sister Monique Morris, Sister Janetta Nemhard, Sister Alicia Surti Thomas. Sister Lisa Thomas Jameson. Sister Ruth Tuller. Sister Jacqueline Wickfall. Brother Jason Williams. Sister Gail Williamson. Can you please give them a round of applause for their achievement? God bless you.
Thank you, graduates. Next, we're asking spiritual gifts. Spiritual gifts. This was led by our pastor, Pastor Stewart.
Praise the Lord, everyone. How many are still praising? Still rejoicing? Because that's what you do. Amen. I'm very delighted to be a part of this class. Elder Sermo was our assistant teacher, and we had a wonderful time in spiritual gifts. We have actually three different classifications for this class because I give a lot of work. So there's either the attendance certificate where you just come and you benefit. There's also the completion certificate where you do the weekly discussion prompt. And they're also the high achievers. Those high achievers not only did every prompt they had for every week, but they scored above an 80 on the test. So we give God praise. We start, well, with Maxim Dennett. Carlene Harewood. Jayla Thomas. They all had the attendance certificate. We give God praise for them. Then we had those that received the completion certificate. I was very pleased. We had a lot of young people in the class that delivered and represented. Alex Barracks. Cheryl Edwards. Claudette Harrison. Ryan Laidlaw. Zachary McKenzie. Raiden Sorty. And Judah Stewart and Antoine Walters. And although they say I give a lot of work, we had a lot of high achievers. Milton Allen, Rooney Allen, Felicia Barracks, Charles L. J. Barrett. I'm not used to calling him Charles. Lloyd Barrett. Mark Bryan. Felicia Bryan. Yvonne Campbell. Marcia Conyers. Simone Dwyer. Kim DeMarge. Alexia Ford. Stephanie Faust. Charles Hayward. Corrine Hickson. Andrew John. Sandria O'Neill. Tariq Rose. Donna Weeks. And Rona Wisdom. Can we give God a praise for the spiritual gift class for 2024? Amen. They need to get a picture. Just come on a little bit closer. Let them get a picture. Amen. Amen. I want to encourage you, as they do that, if you did not take an 8-week course, we're going to start one right after Easter. And I implore you, I encourage you to study to show yourself approved. Amen. How many want to give God a praise that you were in a class this semester and God moved mightily? Amen. Thank you, spiritual gifts. Thank you so much. Thank you, thank you, thank you. What happened? Oh, you want to refer to a picture? God is good. All right, thank you so much. All right, it feels like a Calvary, every week is some big piece of news. Are you ready for another good piece of news before we transition to the offer tonight, today? God is wonderful. We are connecting through, say it loud. I said we're connecting through, and it's my delight to let you know that today we have another marriage engagement announcement. All right, I'm not going to tell you if you're not more excited. I said we have another. Who is it? We're very delighted to say that God is moving by His Spirit and pulling people together. And we actually have known this for a little bit, but we're delighted to let you know, drum roll please, that Sister Zita McKenzie and Serge are engaged to be married. Come on, come on, come on, come on, Serge. Zita, come here, come here, come here. Come on, the two of you, can you come forward, please? Now talk about undercover romance. Come, Serge, come, Serge. Somebody say, the Lord is doing it. The Lord is doing it. Come on, we should stand and give God praise with it. This is exciting news. Amen, amen. We celebrate with them. We celebrate. Zita has been here for almost the entire history of the church. Serge got saved about 2 years ago. And isn't God wonderful? He's faithful. He always comes through and meets the desire of your heart. So even, I don't want to say she's a little bit more mature, but how many of God does fulfill promises? You just have to keep believing and keep faithful. I'm going to have them both say something real quickly.
Praise the Lord, Calvary. First and foremost, I'd like to thank our Lord Jesus Christ. Opportunity. He led me to a great church. Yeah. And then I would like to thank Calvary, besides, despite our difference in terms of background and ethnicities, they received me with open arms and made me feel at home. So thank you for your unwavering love and support. When I just met Zita, we started to talk. And she invited me to church. I felt it in my heart, she was the one for me. started to know each other, and then our relationship started to grow. We have discovered that we have a lot of things in common. We shared a lot of common things and values. And we asked ourselves, why don't we get married? After all, that would be the right thing to do. And here we are. On the other hand, I want my life to have the reputation of someone who wants to follow God. Amen. Therefore, I feel compelled to sustain with certain norms in order to be in full obedience with him. So I came from so far and he saved my life. I wanted to have a strong and steadfast relationship with him. Thank you.
Can you give them a hand clap, please? God bless you. God bless you. He took up all your time. Isn't church a wonderful experience? Amen. Can you pray that God will keep them, touch them, and they'd have a beautiful reunion? How many are excited because we are on a 21-day journey? Who is doing this journey with me and with us? Amen. I want to thank the team that's working with us. We've never done this before, but we stepped up our game for Easter this year. And we have, thank you. And we want us to celebrate what God is doing. I was talking to Sister Corrine, and she was sharing to me, come Sister Corrine, real quickly, because now they take up our time. Share with me how one of the prompts in the course of this last week truly impacted her, and she saw God move. I wanted to share that with you real quickly.
Praise the Lord, Calvary. Come on, we don't praise the God like that. Praise the Lord, Calvary. Amen. So one of the prompts last week actually was share with people around you, three people actually, about you're praying for them, you're thinking of them, and if they have any needs for us to go, that I will pray or you will pray for them. So I said, you know, our God is exceeding God, and I don't like to do things for the kingdom in a small way. So I said, why stop at three? So I sent out that text. I'm thinking of you. You crossed my mind. Is there any needs in your life that you'd like me to pray for? So I sent to Amsterdam, I sent to Africa, I sent to Belgium, I sent in America here, all around. And the responses I got was amazing. There's so many people that have needs and they would not say anything. So I want to encourage the church to reach out to your friends, your family, put it on Facebook. You'll be surprised to know the response you get. And guess what? It's an encouraging thing to know someone is thinking of you and willing to pray for you. God bless you and be encouraged.
Amen. So we have the power and the ability to share the word and be the voice of one crying in the wilderness. We also had an awesome, awesome canvassing and mailer putting together our time yesterday. Over 51 people came out to help us do that. And I want to celebrate them. I want to share this with you real quickly. Amen. If you could run the clip, please. Presence. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
So I'm so super excited that you have decided to join us today. We're only doing this twice, today and next week.
Come on, praise the Lord, praise the Lord. What an awesome time he had yesterday. I just want all the persons who were on the canvassing yesterday just to stand as we extend our appreciation. Thank you for coming out. Also, I want to also thank those persons who have texted in to say that they saw that they could not make it, but next week certainly they will be there. Thank you too. So next week we are going out again. Come on, say again. And we're going to stretch our wings wider. Come, say wider. Because we have a lot more areas to cover. So we need the numbers to double. Come on, somebody say double. So we're not going to have just over 50, but we're going to have over 100. Amen? Praise be to God. So we can get this done. God is doing a tremendous thing in Calvary. Praise be to God. I can feel it in my spirit. Praise God. You know, yesterday while I was making the final round, and when I came around, the sister Nikisha had the kids, and they were so excited. And I remember one of the little ones said, "Sir, I have 3 left. Can you help me?" So I took 2, and I said, "Okay, I will help you." And she went and she gave someone, you know, the card that she had, and I helped her with the 2. Then Alex had 1 card, and Alex insists that he's not going back with his card. He's going to hand it to someone. Praise God. And at the end of it, he gave it to a gentleman, and the gentleman was so happy to get the card invitation. Praise be to God. So we are doing it this year again. Praise God. Amen. So come out. And also, I just want to make a final push for those who did not volunteer and fill out the cards as yet. We're encouraging you to do that. We need more persons. Come on. Say to the neighbor, we need more persons. Say to the next person beside you, we need more persons. Come on. We are in it together. God bless you.
Amen. Give God a praise for Elder Walters. Amen. We're about to prepare you to give this morning. But before I do, I just want to just punctuate what he said. Back in the day, and I don't want to go back into be that old person that says, you know, the good old days, the good old days. But when spring came around, Calvary was always on the streets. How many remember this? We were on the streets every weekend sharing the message. And in this season, obviously we do things a little different. Our social media has kind of taken the place of that. But how many know in the time we have not been there, as we counted yesterday, there are other churches on the streets sharing the word of God. And I don't believe we should concede territory to anybody when we are in this community and in this area. Amen. So I want to encourage you. I want to thank all the leadership. I asked them about 2 weeks ago to cancel all events, cancel all practices. I needed everybody to participate in this from 10 to 1. That's all we need. So I'm going to ask all the leadership, if you have any events, any practices, you should not be doing anything contrary to this effort. Because we have to be unified together. Somebody say, we have to be unified together. And also, I'm very excited because this week we had our 3 days of prayer and fasting. How many were part of the prayer and fasting effort this week? Amen. And over 120 people joined us in our 3 nights of prayer in the sanctuary. Can we give God a praise for what he is doing? Come on, we can do better than that. As we consecrate our hearts, consecrate our spirits, and prepare ourselves for this most holy time of the year. One last thing I want to say, I just want to also acknowledge all of you that have committed to do something and serve in the Easter campaign and commitment effort. Those names are on the board. Now, I've been celebrating all morning, but this I can't really celebrate because we can do better. Amen? The names on the board represent those that have signed up. I'm going to ask you, if you have not signed up, lift your hands. All over this room, lift your hands if you haven't. Lift up your hands high. I'm not gonna. Okay, ushers, if you could work with me, please. If you could work with us. Ushers, move quickly. There are forms. We cannot do 1,200 people in 2 services with only 45 responses. How many agree? Amen. I need some more help in here. We need everyone working together. Ushers, if you could move quickly, please. Keep your hands raised high. Keep your hands raised high. If you'd like to help us do this work, we need volunteers in every area of this church serving. They're going to help you. Keep your hands raised. Keep your hands raised. Keep your hands raised, please. We need your help. If you're new to the church, we need your help. If you're old to the church, we need your help. We need everybody volunteering for at least 1 area of service. If they could put those up on the screen for me and help me as well. We're very delighted to say that those that wanted to help with the choir, that area is completely filled. Chantel, if you can help me with a slide. Those that wanted to also help with the canvassing, again, we're looking to double the canvassing, but we have 50-something people on Saturday. Those that were helping with the altar workers, that is already done and filled. We had a tremendous time in the altar workers training. But we do need new guest services. We got 7 responses. We need 20. We need some folks to help in our kids and teaching ministry. We got 8 responses. We need 20. We need folks to help with our social media task force. We got 2 responses. We need 40. So let me ask you this. I'll stop here and I'll move on to the offering. How many of you are on social media? You're on social media. Can you stand if you're on social media? Any type of, you're on social media. Don't lie in the house of the Lord. Stand if you're on social media. Stand if you're on social media. Stand if you're on social media. If you post, if you're on YouTube, if you're on any part of social media, stand. Now this is important. Hear me. I'm gonna get the energy back in the room in a minute. But it's very important that we share, like, and spread the gospel. They have told us that no more is handing out flyers the way to spread the gospel. The way to spread the gospel is on social media. Amen? And so you may be seated. So if you can help us, it doesn't take much to be a part of the task force. Every time we send something out, we're going to send you an alert, and all you do is like and share. That's it. Is that easy? Amen. So I need your help. We need your help because we're going to do this thing. And as Elder Walter said, I feel like this is a whole new reemergence of Calvary. I don't know if we're going bigger or better, but God is about to do something extraordinary in our midst. Amen? And I want to be a part of it. We're going to prepare you to receive today's tithing and offering, but I found that you are the best witnesses of what we're doing. So, LJ, let's do this. If we have any guests in the house, can you stand, please, this morning? We want to celebrate you and make you feel loved and welcome for the first. I know there are many of you in here, so can you please stand. There's more of you. Please stand. Somebody greet them and welcome them to the house of the Lord this morning. In fact, why don't we all stand together and just shake somebody's hand, make somebody feel loved, and let them know that this is a day that the Lord has made, all right? Come on. Let's do it together. Let's do it together. You've been better than good to me. You've been better than good to me. Hey. Oh, you've been better than good to me. You've been better than good to me. I should have been dead. How many know it's true? Oh, should have lost my mind. You may be seated. We're moving. We had a lot today on the schedule, but we're moving pretty good. So we're going to give you 4 ways to give this morning, either through our app or Zelle, or you may come to the side to give by ATM. Again, if you're not on an app, I want to encourage you to jump on the app because the app records your giving instantaneously and it puts it in right away so you can see it as you give. So if you're not on the app, I want to encourage you to do so. But how many have found that God is faithful? How many have found that God will never fail? And God is the rewarder of them that diligently seek him, but those that are faithful unto him. And so this that we do is an exercise in proving God. The Bible said, prove me. And he said, when we prove him, he'd open up the windows of heaven. So this morning, we want to encourage you to continue to be faithful to God. As Bishop said, during Easter, there's a lot that goes into preparing Easter, a lot of expenses going out. We prepared over 4,000 meals to go all around the region yesterday, and all that costs and takes money and finances. So we want to encourage all of you that are faithful to this house. You are tithers in this house. We want to encourage you to be faithful. And all those that are giving and serving, we want you to also to be faithful as well. Can I have all the tithers in the house? Can you stand this morning? We wanna give God a praise for all of you. If you are a tither in this house, if you give and you're faithful in tithing and offering in this house, we want you to stand at this time. We want to decree on you a blessing. Amen. How many know that God honors faithfulness? And when we are consistent with him, he will not turn his back on us. And so we prove God this morning. We prove God this morning. I wonder if you could look around and tell somebody, I've proven God over and over and over and over. I don't know how many times God has, we have exercised faith, me and Lady Janice, and believed God for something and gave what we did not have, and God blessed us and favored us. And so this is an opportunity like never before today to give unto him, and we do it with gladness. Somebody say we do it with gladness. We found out that the God of heaven, he will prosper us. Therefore, we, his servants, will arise and build. Stand, because these are not debts that we owe, but these are seeds that we sow, and we sow them into good ground. And we're believing that the kingdom of heaven will be established as we do so. Freely we have received, and freely we give. And so this morning we celebrate what God is about to do. And I'm asking everyone in this house to understand that your giving is seen by God. Can you wave your hands and say, God sees my giving. Dear Father, we come before you. We thank you for who you are and what you have done, because you are the God of abundance. A cattle on a thousand hills is yours. You own everything. And we are thus stewards of what you have given to us. So as we come forward now, we ask, oh God, as we're faithful to you, we honor a commandment that you have given for us to tithe and give, that you'd bless our hands, bless our endeavors, bless what we do, bless our going in and our coming out. May we be favored this week. May we receive, oh God, tremendous checks in the mail, and may there be victory reports this week as we give unto you. We give it because we know you're faithful and you'll never fail. We give it and we praise you. We come celebrating. All the people of God said, in Jesus' name, amen. Can you come rejoicing? The ushers are serving you at this time as you come.
You're gonna live to see it happen.
You're gonna live to see it happen.
You're gonna live to see it happen.
thank God for what he's doing. We have a baby dedication this morning. Egypt Tori Flemings, if the family could come real quickly. As those of you standing, can you clap your hands? Come on, clap, clap, clap. You're proving God. But you're also decreeing and declaring that this week you're going to live. How many know you're going to live? Tell your neighbor that you're not going to just live, but you're going to live well. You're going to live victoriously. You're going to live in abundance. Come on, decree and declare. Come on, CJ. Hey.
You're going to.
We're so honored and delighted this morning to welcome Egypt Tori Flemings. We're dedicating her to the Lord this morning, and we're so grateful for her parents, Tony Del Pratt and Andre Flemings. And mom has a beautiful smile. We're so happy to have the extended family this morning with us. We're so thankful that you're here today in the house of the Lord. Can we make them feel welcome and warm? We thank you that you chose us to dedicate your baby to the Lord, and we're going to give her back to God because she belongs to the Lord. And God has great plans in store for her, and we're going to just ask the congregation just to pray this morning. Lord, we thank you this morning for your goodness and your grace. We're so grateful that we have the privilege this morning of coming to your presence, Lord, and to dedicate, oh God, this morning Egypt for your glory and for your purpose. We lift her up before you this morning, Lord God, and ask, Lord God, that you keep your hand upon her, Lord God. We thank you for bringing her through this morning and allowing her to be here today. And so, God, we're giving her back to you, Lord God, for you to use for your purpose and for your glory. We pray that you'll provide and meet every need in her life, oh God. I pray as she goes through the various stages of life, oh God, that you will be with her, that you will protect her, Lord God, that you will provide for her, oh God, that she will find a friend in you, that she will find a father, that she will find the Lord in you, oh God. And Lord God, we pray for the parents this morning. We pray your hand upon them, Lord God. We pray your blessings upon them, oh God. We pray your covering, oh God. We ask, Lord Jesus, that you give them wisdom. Oh God, when they're faced with things that they don't know what to do, I pray they will look to you, God, and be reminded that, Lord God, Egypt belongs to you, oh God. Remind them, Lord God, that you will provide everything that she needs and that pertaineth to life, oh God. And, oh God, we pray for good health. We pray for wisdom. We pray for guidance. We pray for favor, Lord God, in everything, Lord Jesus. And we pray, oh God, for the community and the family and the friends that came today. May they always be there and be a good, oh God, example to her, oh God. Lord, we give you thanks and we give you praise. In the name of Jesus, and everybody say, in Jesus' name, we pray, amen.
We are going to anoint her. Can you just stretch your hands towards her? And we're going to anoint her that God will use her for his glory. Lord, we thank you right now that you would give her the wisdom. We anoint her head, Jesus. Your wisdom that comes from above. We ask God that she will have the mind of Christ. And whatever she do, God Almighty, you will take her to places and expand her. Her eyes have not seen and ears have not heard, neither have they entered into the hearts of men the things that God have prepared for them that love him. So God Almighty, touch her body. This is the temple of the Holy Ghost. God dwell in her, God Almighty. Even at a young age, God Almighty, stir up the gifts, the calling, and the ability.
Oh God, you promised and you said, God, that she's the head and not the tail. Oh God, let her serve you, Jesus. Let this voice declare your promises. Let her go before nations and speak, thus saith the Lord. Oh God Almighty, put your words in her, God Almighty, and let her body be a worship unto you, Jesus. Anoint her hands for warfare. Let these hands be gifted, God. Let be lifted up and surrender all glory to you. Oh God, let these hands, God, do great things for the kingdom in the word, God. Give her favor where she go. Oh Jesus, touch her feet, God, as she go. Let it be like hands' feet, God. We pray, God, that she's more than a conqueror. Wherever she go, territories will be hers. In the name of Jesus, she will walk in leadership. She will walk in the path of righteousness. Those, God Almighty, the steps of a righteous man is ordered by the Lord. So, God, we declare upon her, Jesus, that you, God, submit her to you, Jesus. Her body, her soul, her mind, God Almighty. We thank you, Jesus. Let your word be a lamp unto her feet and a light to her path, God Almighty. We thank you, Jesus. Let your glory rest upon her, Jesus, as she is under an open heaven. In Jesus' name, we thank you. Hallelujah.
She also receives a bond to start her career. So put that into good use. And we hope that we will be a blessing. We'll see you guys again. Amen. Amen. Can you give God a praise for this family? Amen. We're about to hear the word of the Lord. And I thank all of those that participated today. We had a lot to say, a lot to share. Amen. But we've kept a pretty good time to give Bishop a chance. I just want to say in closing, if you are relatively new to the church, you came through the new members class, and you have not found a place, that's about to stand. We're going to have one more song of worship. I want to make sure you touch base with Lady Janice. Her and the team is working to assimilate you and get you involved, get you into ministry. They actually had a great event where even in that fellowship event, one person received the Holy Ghost in that fellowship event. Amen. And so God is doing wonderful things in the house of the Lord. I just want to also remind you that next week is Palm Sunday. And as some of you are already in your green, next week we're going to be all in green. We're going to have a wonderful time. Some wonderful surprises await us next week. So everybody say Palm Sunday. Amen. We're going to be hearing from the founder and the visionary of this house this morning. He's coming with the word of the Lord. But the praise he was going to lead us in a quick song of worship and praise. And the next voice you will hear is our bishop.
We lift our hands to you, O God. We give you glory, Jesus.
I give myself.
I give myself away.
So you can do.
I give myself.
myself to your. Help me say.
Glory to God. Can you raise your hands to him? Say, Lord, here I am. Give it all to you. Withholding nothing. Give myself to you. Look down your row and tell your neighbor that's the best gift you can give to God today. Yourself. Amen. You may be seated. We greet you this morning in the Lord. We're excited to be in God's presence. And I'm convinced every day above ground is a good day. Let me try it again. Every day above ground is a good day. This is the day the Lord hath made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. Church, the ministers, the executive leaders and directors, and everyone that's working so hard to further the cause of Christ. This is the greatest kingdom. Amen. And just to be a part of it is an honor. Amen. I need someone to give God praise right there for the honor. Hallelujah. Somebody told me once that God doesn't need us, but he needs us. God doesn't need us, but he needs us. And anytime we think that we are so needed and get high-minded, he can just turn to the stones. But I'm honored today and giving God praise that he has allowed us to be part of this great ministry. I'm going to give you 20 seconds just to give God honor for allowing you and I to be part of his great church and ministry. You may be seated. Let me do it this way. Just suppose they change the laws of the United States. They modify the Constitution. And they allow president to serve more than two terms. And think with me that Barack and Michelle ran and they won to become our president again. And they came to Calvary and tapped all of you to serve in the administration. How would you feel? So let me just say, United States government is not the greatest government. And Barack and Michelle, as much as we love them, they're not as great and powerful as our God. And you have been handpicked to serve in his cabinet. You got 20 seconds
to give God praise for allowing you to serve. I think you got it now. Allowing you to be a part. Transportation, finance, energy.
Amen. You may be seated. We count it an honor to serve. I'm delighted to have my mother in the service today again. Delighted to have my children in the service today. Give Lennox and Crystal a hand clap of praise. And then I want to give a shout out to Elder Wayne today. On Friday, he's going to celebrate his anniversary with my sister. We've been married for 37 years. And we give God praise for that. Thank God. Let's get to the word of the Lord. Pastor has been saying that they did a whole lot, but they kept to the time. But I have this sheet in there. Hallelujah. So I said, Lord, how am I going to get through this? I have 11 pages. How am I going to get through this? And so he and I had a back and forth. What do I do that can make you give me more time than's allotted? And so I was in between wearing my robe and wearing clergy clothes. Because some of the saints know if you put the robe on, hope Bishop has something to say. But then I couldn't tell if the robes were here or where they were. And so I ended up wearing my clergy shirt. So by wearing this, I'm asking you to give me some clergy time. But I'm going to do my best to stick to the time in Jesus' name. Amen? Stand with me, please, if you would. Matthew chapter 14 and Mark chapter 4. These are two stories that the Lord allowed his disciples to record with him having an encounter with them in a storm. And both stories, if you read them, and you might think they are the same, but there are differences in the stories and different lessons to be learned. So I'm just going to go straight to verse number 33 of chapter 14. Then they that were in the ship came and worshipped him, saying, of a truth, thou art the Son of God. Then the next story, Mark chapter 4, we're going straight to the last verse, verse number 41. And they feared exceedingly and said one to another, what manner of man is this that even the wind and the sea obey him? At the end of their storm experience, the disciples in Matthew 14 worshipped. At the end of the storm experience recorded in Mark, they were left questioning. I want to preach today about strengthening relationship through storms. Strengthening relationship through storms. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for your call and your anointing. We are eternally grateful. We honor you for having called us into the ministry and anointed us to do the work. But Lord, we stand now in your presence in the midst of your people. And we ask for your glory to rest upon us so that your will be done. Your kingdom will come in our midst. And Lord, we pray not for it to happen only here in the sanctuary, but around the world. Wherever the gospel is being preached and your name is being declared, let your kingdom come and let your will be done. And we give you praise in advance for hearing us and answering us. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated.
their different style of preaching in different ways of exegeting the text and dealing with the matter. And the one I chose today is one of the hardest ones to do. To compare and contrast two stories. Why is it so difficult? Because folks can hardly focus on one story, much less two. Slap yourself on both knees so you can walk and chew gum at the same time. So I needed to work with me. Amen? I'm not sure if we're going to teach or preach, but whatever happens, I'm trying to get a message across to you today. Let's go into it. First, let me establish from the very outset that the Lord, He is master over every storm. He's Lord of the storms. Psalm 107 says, "For He commanded and raised the stormy wind, which lifted up the waves thereof. He maketh the storm a calm, so that the waves thereof are still." Nahum says, "The Lord hath His way in the whirlwind and in the storm. And the clouds are the dust of His feet." 135, David writes, "He causeth the vapors to ascend from the ends of the earth. He maketh lightnings for rain. He bringeth the wind out of His treasuries." What a mighty God. Psalm 148, "Praise the Lord from the earth, ye dragons and all deeps. Fire and hail, snow and vapor, stormy wind, fulfilling His word." Jonah writes, "But the Lord sent out a great wind into the sea, and there was a mighty tempest in the sea, so that the ship was like to be broken." The storms of life that we experience are under the control of our great God. Let me try it again. The storms of life that you and I experience are ordered by God and under His control. That's a praise break right there. Tell the devil, "I can't sink. I won't drown because my master is in control of the storm." If you are going through a storm right now, you ought to give God praise and celebrate Him. Hallelujah. Storms are not designed to sink you. You might lose some stuff. You might lose the ship in which you're traveling. And you might be scared. But we need to be assured that we will not lose our lives because of storms that God sends. So in Acts chapter 27, the Bible says, "And now I exhort you to be of good cheer. There shall not be no loss of any man's life among you, but of the ship." This is the Apostle Paul, amen, when he was going through a storm in Acts chapter 27. And Paul had told them, "Before you venture out, I'm warning you that there is going to be danger." And but they still went ahead. And then Paul spent some time praying. And God told him to tell them, "We're going to lose the ship. We're going to lose some stuff. But there's not going to be any loss of life." So let me prophesy and decree over this congregation. I don't care what storm that you got yourself into, the Lord told me to tell you, you're not going to lose your life. You're not going to lose your husband. You're not going to lose your children. You're not going to lose your friends. This storm is going to bring God glory and grow you up. I need a praiser right now. I just told you, you're going to make it on the other side, and you're not going to lose your life. I need 10 folks to tell God, "Thank you. I will not die, but I will declare your glory." Hallelujah. So point number one from the two texts. In some storms, the Lord will go with you, and in some storms, he will send you alone. Let's look at the two stories. Mark chapter 4, 35. And the same day, when the even was come, he said unto them, let us pass over on the other side. Matthew 14, in the other story, the storm, Matthew writes, and straightway Jesus constrained his disciples to get into a ship and to go before him on the other side. Let me say, those are on this side, your storm, you're going to have Jesus with you. Amen. This side, your storm, you're going alone. But whether Jesus is with you or you're alone, if he said to go, it's going to be all right. No. I'm trying to keep the clock, but if you don't get it, you're going to make me work harder. You got Jesus with you. You don't have Jesus with you, but it's still gonna be. I thought you were praising God more. It's if he's with me or he's not with me, it's going to be all right. So let the devil know, I don't feel him. I don't see him. It doesn't seem like he's answering me, but I know it's going to be all right. Slap yourself on your left knee and say, it's going to be all right. Storm, here I come. It's interesting to note in Matthew 14 that the Lord sent to them, go before him on the other side. It's the only occasion we have in the New Testament where he instructed them to go before him. There are some things that you're going to have to do. God's going to instruct you to do and put you out front. And he's going to stay behind. Say hallelujah. That's a tough order. Because we have been trained to follow him. What do you do when you have to walk? When you don't see the pathway, you have to go by yourself. So let's work the text. So those are the two verses. The same day when evening was come, he said unto them, let us pass over on the other side. Straightway, he constrained his disciples to get into the ship and go before him on the other side. Can I then announce whether he goes with me or I go before him, I'm going to get. Where are my musicians? I don't know. Last week we changed the time. You should have been adjusted by now, but you're mad at tight. I think I'm going to need some help on the music. Whether he goes with me or I go before him, I'm going to get to the other side. Wherever he sends me, I don't care what happens between it, I am going to make it. Don't let the devil make you believe because you are going to encounter a storm that the storm is going to take you out. You've got to prophesy to yourself, this too shall pass.
and the storms won't last forever. Is there anybody in the house that has been through a physical storm? Can you stand up? I need some testimonies. Did the storm pass? And look at you standing, you're still alive. So why are you freaking out now? Because you're experiencing another storm. Throw both hands up and say, I'm going to make it. High five your neighbor and say, you're going to make it. Are you ready for the next comparison contrast? Are you ready? Let's work it. Verse 36, Mark. And when they had sent away the multitude, they took him, even as he was in the ship, and there were also with him other little ships. Note, he said to them, let us go over on the other side. And the disciples sent the multitude away. Go to Matthew. He said, go before me on the other side. And straightway Jesus constrained the disciples to get into the ship and to go before him on the other side. While he sent the multitudes away. And when he had sent the multitudes away, we picked that up. So I want to tell you, to get to the other side, there is going to be a need for separation. If he's going with you, you're going to have to send the multitudes away. If you are going before him, or is it the other way around, you're going to have to send the multitudes away. But in either case, in both scenarios, the multitudes have to be sent away. You're not going to the other side with the present company that you're keeping. They are not assigned to go with you on the other side. So you've got to make up your mind to either send them away, and if you don't have the strength to send them away, let God send them away. I just said a whole lot right there. Before you get to the other side, you're going to have to get rid of some people or allow God to get. They are not assigned to go to the other side with you. They have freeloaded long enough. They have been baggage long enough. They haven't paid their passage long enough. But now that he has assigned you to go, you've got to drop them. Oh, Lord, help me, Holy Ghost. Pastor, this is what the Lord said to tell you. Don't worry. You don't have the courage to send them away. But to get to the next level, there's some people that have to leave. Oh, Lord. Now you love me. Why you know, so I used to do it every 3 months and so tell folks, if this is not the church for you, find somewhere else to go where you can hear the voice. Because I've learned a long time that everybody's not going to the same place with you. There are levels in God that you got to drop off people. Oh, Lord. You can't win this battle, Gideon, with 32,000. Too many are with you. You got to take them by the river. Oh, Lord God. This is not Sunday school. And let them lap the water like a dog. And then watch them drink. And then select them. We've got too many people to get to the other side. Oh, Lord.
Now you and I, we're too nice to tell people, amen, you gotta go. And some of you that God has already gotten rid of people, you need to stop trying to bring them back into your life. It's tight, but it's right. I didn't make up the story. What God is about to do in your life, the experience you're going to have next, you got too many people with you. And you need to be delivered from the multitude. Now I'm going to give you a moment. All of you that can't send them away, would you be bad enough to ask the Lord to send them away? Some of you that can't delete them out of your phone, can you ask God just to not allow you to pay the phone bill no more? You have a question to ask. Do you want to go to the other side? Or do you want to still hang out with the multitude? If you want to go to the other side, stand to your feet and say, let them go. Right, you may be seated. Separation is important. It sends storms in our lives to separate us from people around so he can teach us what we need to be taught. Let me draw an example for you from Abraham. The Lord appeared to Abraham, Genesis 12, and said, get thee out of thy country and from thy kindred and from thy father's house unto a land that I will show thee. I'm not going to show you the land until you leave your father's house and all of your family members. Anytime God calls us to something new and different, there's a need for us to be separated from people that have a certain familiarity, because you will never be accepted to do what God has called you to do. Because to them, you're still Fletcher. To them, you're still Brother Barry. A prophet has no honor among his own people. And people, because of familiarity, don't have any respect. And anything you don't respect, you will be disconnected from. I just said a whole lot right there. Don't let the devil cause you to disrespect anybody in your life, because very soon the disrespect is going to disconnect you. So God knows it's going to happen, so he decided just to tell you to do it up front. Clap your hands. So Abraham got the command from God, and God gave him a faithful covenant. But Abraham did not leave all his kindred. When we read in Genesis 13, the Bible says he took Lot with him. Slap yourself on your left knee and say, lean in. He's teaching now. He took Lot with him. And he took Lot with him, bless the parents, down to Egypt. And there in Egypt, he got rich, got a whole lot of cattle, all the gold, and come up with a whole lot of stuff. And the land was not able to bear them that they might dwell together, for their substance was great, so that they could not dwell together. And there was strife between the herdsmen of Abram's lot and the herdsmen of Lot's cattle. When you take people with you to the other side that should not go with you, they become participator of your blessing. And they have no appreciation that what they got was because of you. And because they can't give you any celebration, can't give you any credit, there's going to be strife. I'm telling you, if you don't let them go now, you're going to have problems later. I told the pastor I'm working, this is the preview, I'm working the message, cut those suckers loose. I told you before, right? I'm halfway through it. Let them go now. Because by the time you share your Gucci bag with them and they start buying better weaves and they start living better lives because of your connection to God and your covenant with God, they're going to believe it's them. Say strife. Gets better. And then Abraham was smart enough to say, you know what? This is not going to work, Loy. He says, all right, Lot, we got to go. Let that be no strife. He says, look to the land. Look at the land. And I'm giving you first choice. Chapter 13, 10. And Lot lifted up his eyes and beheld all the plain of Jordan that was well watered everywhere. And Lot chose him all the plain of Jordan. He lifted up his eyes and he looked and he saw the good fertile land. It means the other part, which we know, was all rocky and desert. And Lot chose him all. Now I'm asking the question, will you let them go? Because if you don't, you're going to create strife and they're going to end up being selfish and take everything from you. Now you know why I want to wear my robe. Because he told me, don't look on their faces. This is going to be tough. Make up your mind if you believe that God has already given you the land. You don't want to give it to people that God did not assign it to. And he's going to take you to the other side, but you got to let them go. Strife, selfishness, that would have been bad by itself, those twofold things would have been bad. But I found another example that happened. After Abraham took Lot, God stopped speaking to him. Let me prove it to you. Genesis 13. And the Lord said to Abraham, after that Lot was separated from him. So when God spoke to him in 12, and all the journeys that he went down and got rich and all the stuff, God stopped speaking. Some of you are just living on the benefits of what God said to you before. But he's not giving you direction on the next step. Because you got people with you that he doesn't want to tell you because he's afraid, if God can be afraid, that you're going to tell them his business. So he stopped speaking. But when Abraham says, Lot, you got to go, God spoke to him again. And God says, now. Somebody say now. Lift up thine eyes and look from the place thou art, northward and southward and eastward and westward, for all the land which thou seest, to thee will I give it, unto thy seed forever. Let Lot have what he took. I still got more for you. Oh God. I need somebody that wants God to speak to them. I need somebody that don't want strife in their life and for selfishness be manifested, to cut those people off now so we can go to the other side. How many in the house believe God has more for you than you're enjoying right now? And he's calling you to come on a journey. Let them go. One can chase. Two can put. You don't need a whole lot of people. God can save by few, but the multitude will delay your destiny. You know, we teach church growth, but we don't teach it correctly. Crowd can hinder growth. Because some of them in the crowd, all they want is the fish and the bread. And when you tell them that you got to drink his blood and eat his flesh, they say, we didn't sign up for this. We sign up for fish and bread. We ain't drinking no blood and eating no flesh. The devil is a lie. I want to see those in the house that are ready to eat his flesh and drink his cup. That you're ready to be a partaker of his suffering. Come on and stand to your feet and say, I'm going to the other side. And I'm going there with only those that God has assigned to be in the boat. Sit. So they got in the ship, set the multitude away, and then when we get to the third point I want to make today is, whatever God puts you in to go through the storm, be assured it's built for it and built to last. Watch the story now. He told in Mark 4:37, and there arose a great storm of wind, and the waves beat into the ship, so that it was now. So the water got into the ship. Are you with me? When we read Matthew, but the ship was now in the midst of the sea, tossed with the waves, for the wind was contrary. So in Mark's account, when the storm, a great storm came, and the wind start blowing, and the waves start heaping up, the waters got into the ship. In Matthew's account, the ship was in the midst of the sea, tossed with the waves, for the wind was contrary. The water did not get into the ship in Matthew's account. What's my point? Number one, make sure that when the storms are raging, the effects of the storm don't get inside of you. Because ships were built to ride on water and float on water and ride on waves. They are not designed to carry water. Be careful lest any root of bitterness enter into you and you be defiled. Do you remember when God told Noah to build the ark? Yeah.
He said, pitch it within and pitch it without. The aim was, Noah, I'm going to flood this place. But this ship that you're going to be in with the animals, the water will not affect you. I've come to preach to a few folks that's allowing the cares of life and the storms of life to get into you, and you are becoming bitter, and you don't know that your boat is about to sink. You're allowing what people say about you to affect your praise. You're allowing people's opinion about you to affect your worship. You're causing what people say to affect your giving. But I've come to tell you, let it stay on the outside and don't let it get on the inside. You've got to say, Lord, keep my heart with all diligence, for out of it are the issues of life. I want my heart pure. You can talk about me, but I'll still love you. You can, oh, come on, say hallelujah. You can lie on me, but I'll still love you. You can backbite, but I'll still love you. I won't let what you do to me affect what God has done on me. Say yeah. Say yeah. Tell the devil, it's not getting into my spirit. Fire me. I believe God has another way to feed me.
God bless Joanne. One Sunday, we had a little fight before church. Not like a verbal thing. And I came to church, I preached a storm up. And we're driving the car. I said, how come you're so mad? And you're going to church. And I said, I'm mad at you and I'm mad at God.
I need somebody that's mad at somebody, but you're not mad at God. How many of you are angry, but you're not sinning? Say yeah. You're not causing me to lose my composure. Hallelujah.
Whatever people have done to you, my assignment is to tell you,
you are built for this. Woo! And nothing by any means is going to harm you. Hallelujah.
Ain't got no money, but I've got faith. The saints let the boss cause them to lose their joy. All right. Too often, you let the bishop cause you. One of my biblical mentors told me a long time, they will fight, but make sure they're fighting the word. That's why I always give you the word. Fight the word. Don't fight me. I'm just a paid messenger. Woo! And when you go home, you're going to have to fight the word. If I don't have nowhere to go, shut my mouth. Say amen. Don't let people change your attitude.
Don't let situation alter your behavior. Spirit.
Oh my God. I was giving another story, but the time is clicking. Sacred Stephanie left me. I know what he's saying. He doesn't have to demonstrate it. children, spouse, boss, bishop, elder, pastor, don't let nobody steal your joy. This joy that we have, the world didn't. I feel a praise right there. You can talk up, but I'm still gonna have my joy. I might not look like it. Say, built to last. What you're going through change who he made you to be. I feel like they're telling you this and you'll probably like me better. He was led like a sheep to the slaughter. Finish it. But you open. You open your mouth too much. Yes. Sometimes it gets in you. I'll be honest, it gets in me too. But I've learned to sip it. Because it's in me. If I open my mouth, it's going to come out. And after it's come out, it's too late to take it back. So I keep it in. And I say, creating me. Oh, I love you. And renew a right spirit. Because after what they said and after what they did, and I got to lay hands and bless them, it's bubbling up. Yeah. Creating me a clean heart. Let the words of my and the meditation of my be at, before I curse, I said, God, shut me up. Do me like you did Zechariah. Don't let me question what you're doing. Keep my mouth shut until I can bless them. Keep my hands in my pocket until I can help them. I need a praiser to say, God, help me to keep the water out of my boat. Carry bitterness. I'm not built to carry resentment. I'm not built to carry anger. And some storms that you go through, they're going to have different impact on you. Some storms will get things inside of you. But I just told you, if it gets inside of you, it don't have to sink you. I know you're human. I am too. It happens. But what you gotta do is ask God, please hold me. Tie me up, God, until you work inside of me. Am I helping you? I'm going to go home and make it right with your spouse. I just dropped that in there, not me. No witness. You're going to make me a lying prophet. How many going to go home and make it right with your spouse? Because they got on the inside of you. Number four, storms reveal your fears. They're all looking good on the shore after the teaching. When they got in the boat, they were bad enough to send people away, and they were all excited to take Jesus as he was, tired, and put him in the boat. They took him in the boat. And
said, go rest. And they're all excited to start the journey to the other side. But he knew inside of them there were fears. The Holy Ghost said, tell me, you are fearful about many things. And the storm is going to bring your fears to the surface. Let me word this thing. Mark 4. And he was in the part of the ship, asleep on a pillow. And they awake him and said, Master, carest thou not that we perish? And he arose and rebuked the wind and said unto the sea, peace be still. And the wind ceased and there was a great calm. And he said unto them, why are you so fearful? How is it, note, that you have no faith? They just left, if you read early on, it's lent to teaching. Faith cometh by and hearing. But when they got them in the boat and the storm came, he said, you have no faith. In other words, I was speaking, but you were not hearing. Oh, Lord, help me now. Do I have an extra time? How many of you come into church aren't listening to preaching, but you're not hearing? I've been asked by God to tell you what he told the seven churches. He that have an ear to hear, let him hear what the Spirit says. That's why some folks can go through the same storm and come out different than some folks. Some folks go in the storm and walk away from God, curse the church, curse the family, and say, all kind of folk. But some folks go in and they still got their joy, their praise. The reason is somebody got the word on the inside that kept their faith alive. Say hallelujah. Say hallelujah. The reason why the Lord had to rebuke the wind and speak to the sea in Mark's gospel is because they didn't have any faith to do it. The reason why sometimes we have, you might as well like me. The reason why we got long prayer lines, when people are in their storms and we are required to rebuke stuff and speak to stuff, is because the people don't have no faith. Everything that comes, they think it's going to take them out. They don't know, not only can I lay hands on the sick and they shall recover, I can lay hands on my... We don't know how to encourage ourselves in the Lord. What would you do if there was no church this morning and you're going through a storm? Could you preach yourself happy? Could you sing your own song? Could you lift yourself up and give God praise? I don't want another COVID experience, but God knows to put us by ourselves sometimes to make us know we are just surviving because of the multitude. But there's nothing in us. No faith. Think about all the length of time he was with them and they never had any faith. He's in the ship. I'm not even going to say, some of you got the Lord on the ship, but he's sleeping. Wonder why he's sleeping in your life? Because he wants you to experience the storm for you to finally admit, I don't believe you care about me. I don't believe you care about me. Master, carest thou? How can you say that? I just was I compassion the multitude. You said send them away. I said, no, they've been with me a long time. Bring me something, but you God. You're calling me that I don't care? How could you dare say God don't care? Look at your weave. Look at your shoes. Look, oh, come on, help me, somebody. Look, you still got health. You still got legs. After all you did, you're still alive. And you're... But the storm will make you come up and say what's really inside of you. We're going to discover that when the word was sown, the enemy came and took it away from you. We're going to find out that you fell among thorns. I'm preaching too hard. It fell among stones, and it profits you nothing. But there are few folks whose heart. That's why I'm trying to tell you, keep things out of your heart. Because when the word is sown, if your heart is not right, it won't profit you anything. And when the storm comes, you're going to curse God and the bishop. They don't care. Have you heard that? The church don't care. The church cared enough that when you came, the doors were open. And we've been preaching to you a long time to grow you up, to come to the full measure stature of Christ. But because God sent a storm to show that nothing was working, you're angry. You're upset. You that are on Facebook. Not those in the sanctuary. Let's go to Matthew. Matthew 14, 24. But when the ship was now in the midst of the sea, tossed with the waves, for the wind was contrary, and the fourth watch of the night, Jesus went unto them, walking in the sea. And when the disciples saw him walking in the sea, they were troubled by the saying, it is a spirit, and they cried out of fear. What's the difference? In Matthew's account, the waters and the wind was having impact on the ship. But there's no account of them being fearful about the storm. They're riding this thing out. Are you with me? No account. They weren't scared. They didn't go wake him up and tell him, no, no, we can handle this. We can get through this. Hallelujah to God. This is the same group that he said, no, you understand now why. Go ahead before me. Because he knew they had capacity to handle what was going to come. But he went up in the mountain alone to pray. Because he knew what was coming. And it was not the storm that was going to come. You get it? Because they were already in the storm and not scared. But when the fourth watch of the night, he who sent them ahead and had his eyes on them, says now time, watch now, don't lose the story, to show them who I am. So he comes walking on the water. Now they've never seen anybody walk on water. So that phenomenon scared the wits out of them. What on God's earth is this? Some of you have already reached one level in God. You can handle storms, but you can't handle walking, spirits walking on water. Woo. Am I helping you? Read the text when you go home. The storm didn't bother them. They were experiencing it, being tossed to and fro. The water didn't get into their ship either. They kept it on the outside. And the Lord says, now it's time to scare the wits out of them. Let them experience something they have never experienced before. And let me see what they're going to do. Hallelujah. Oh, Lord of mercy. I'm telling you, this last year I experienced stuff I never experienced before. I've been in church and said, Lord, please don't let me pass out. Hold my legs up. I can't tell you. It was scary, right, Zach? But I'm telling you, God is going to make sure that we all grow up. And storms are designed to push your capacity. When you think you learn him, he was want to say, oh God, I'm too high. I'm too wide. There's more to me than you already know. And this is where the saints lose it. They think they have arrived. They know everything about God. And there you try to challenge their faith. We go from faith, from glory, from victory. Slap yourself on your left knee and say, here comes your spirit. And they cried out, it's a spirit. All 12 in the boat. Never seen this before. I'm closing. That's a joke, isn't that? One of them, in the other encounter, written things in John, says, it's the Lord. That's when Peter said, he said to them, be not afraid, it is I. Peter said, if it be thou, Lord. Come on, bid me. Is the storm still going on? Is the ship still being tossed? Are the waves still swelling? Jesus came walking on the water. If it's you, God, bid me come. And the Lord said to him, and Peter stepped out the boat and walked on the stormy waters. Woo! I feel a glory right up in here. The lesson he's teaching in this story, one of them, I can't cover them all, is this. Some people are scared of the storm, and some people can walk in the storm. But it's dependent on your faith. All the other disciples said, nah, not me. I see the waves. I see the water. I see the boat tossing to and fro. Not me. Peter stepped out and he walked on the water. And the Bible says, but when he took his eyes off Jesus, I inserted that, and he saw the wind boisterous and the waves. He's no longer in the ship that was designed to take him on the other side. He stepped into another realm, and he didn't know how to operate in that realm. And God was saying, Peter, I'm about to leave.
And you're going to lead this church. And when I leave, I want you to experience some stuff about me that you can help the church to grow. I'm trying to tell somebody, the Lord is calling you out of what you are used to, that kept you safe all along, into a realm you have no idea how to operate. I'll teach you. I'll teach you how to walk on water. Come, Ryan, walk on water. How do you walk on water? He was sinking, but he didn't sink. He said, Lord, and the Lord helped me. Thank you. The Lord reached out his hand and picked him up. Listen what Jesus said to him. How is it your soul? Let me find it. He said to him, you know, straightway, Jesus said, turn and said, be not afraid. Be of good cheer, desire, be not afraid. And Peter said, if Lord bid me thou, bid me come unto thee on the water. And he said, come. And Peter came down out of the ship and walked in the water to go to Jesus. But when he saw the wind boisterous, he was afraid. And beginning to sink, he cried, saying, Lord, save me. And immediately, Jesus stretched forth his hand and caught him. And said unto him, watch now, O thou of little faith. In Mark's story, they had no faith. So he had to rebuke the wind and speak to the sea. Peter had little faith. So he used that faith that he had to make him walk on the water. The response to no faith that ended up in Mark questioned him. Who is this? What manner of man is this that even the winds and the waves obey? They finally confess. We don't know him. We have no clue who was in the ship. He's been with us a long time, but we don't know him. In Matthew's account, when Peter stepped out and Jesus said he had little faith, the Bible says when he got back in the boat, he and Peter, the storm stopped. Can I hasten to say, some of you rebuking and fasting won't stop your storm. Getting out and walking on the water, going to a next level, is what will bring calm. I just said a whole lot there. Your storm can leave you questioning God, like in Mark's story, because they had no faith. Or your storm can leave you worshiping God because of your little faith. Questioning, stand up, you please, and worshiping are two different things. The act of your worship, saying we know who he is. We identify him now. We have proven him now. If it be thou, bid me come. Come. I know who you are now. I walked on the water. What is your storm
going to do to you. Make you question God? Or is it going to make you worship God? I made up my mind. Even though my storms might bring unique opportunities, stuff we have never experienced before, it's going to cause me to worship God. Because I'm discovering, because of the storm, who he is. Say amen. So I'm going to make the altar call real quickly. And those of you come out. I don't know what storms you're going through right now. But if you've got questions, can I suggest God has answers? We should clap right there. If you've got questions, God has answers. If you are going through a storm and you're committed to continually worship God, I'm calling for you as well. So whatever stage you're in your storm, I want you to come out of your seat. Come into this ship at the altar. And let's create a safe place for you to experience what you're going through. Would you come quickly? If you need healing, come. If you need salvation, come. If you need God's help in any area, come. If you got questions, come. If you don't know what's happening in your life, come. If you got no faith, come. If you got little faith, come. If you don't think he cares, come. If he's asking you to do stuff that you've never done before, come. Come, come quickly, come quickly. Come quickly. Keep clapping your hands, church. Come quickly. If you don't understand this Holy Ghost thing, come. If you're scared of this Spirit thing, come. Come, come. 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 Intercessors, raise your hands. People are going through storms and they need to hear peace be still. Or they need to walk on it. People are on the journey to the other side. And they need to get rid of people around them. And they don't know how to do it. They become dependent on people. Their dependency level has grown to the point where they trust people more than they trust God. And they're not aware that the arm of flesh will fail. People are having strife in their families. People experience selfishness. People stop hearing God speaking. But God has, I need some more altar workers real quickly. Come, 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 come. People have no clue what's going on in their life. They're seeing other people doing a lot of stuff and they're still in the safety of the boat. They want to step out, but they don't know how. Your little faith can't push them out. Come, come. I need some more workers. The harvest truly is plenteous. Come on, laborers. Come on quickly. Come on quickly. Can I get some more praying saints to come and help? Bless you, son. Come. Any brothers in the balcony wants to come down? Ask God to help you. If you feel the Lord is asleep, not acting on your behalf, come on down, help us to wake him up. Hallelujah. One last time, I need some more saints that don't mind helping somebody. Come on out your seat. Here come some young people. Glory to God. 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 Glory to God.
If you can spend 10 more minutes worshiping around the altar, will you draw nearer? Draw nearer. Draw nearer. If you can spend 10 more minutes, just come around the altar. Draw nearer. Let's intensify the atmosphere with worship and praise. These people are in storms. Their lives are in jeopardy. And how they come out of it is important. You're moving too slow. Slip between the aisles. Slip between the seats. Glory to God. Glory to God. Slip between the seats. Thank you so much. If you've got to go, you are dismissed. But these people are going through storms, and we want to spend some time with them. God bless you. See you on Tuesday night. Raise your hands if you're around the altar. Get ready, singers. Come on, altar workers, move in. Here's another young man. Glory to God. Come, son. Come with him. Come right up here. Make room for him, please. He's going to pray. Come on, lift your hands up. So, Lord, save. Lord, deliver. Lord, set free.
In the name of Jesus, help me save.